Hi, my name is Rob Sowerby. I am the Director of Professional Courses at the London School of Business and Finance. I'm delighted to say that today we're at the Brompton Bicycle Factory, where I have the opportunity to speak to Will Butler-Adams, who is the Managing Director.
Very nice to see you.
Will, what makes a Brompton bike so special?
Well, we don't produce a bike that will allow you to fly to the moon. It doesn't mean that suddenly your world becomes better and your children become well-behaved, as some amazing products do. We produce a bike that does what it says. It folds, it unfolds, it rides well, and that ability allows you to have freedom. It works in a city. It allows people to move, to jump in and out of the bus, jump on and out of the tube, get on and out of the train. And in a city that's congested, in movement that's often unpleasant, it's freedom, it's a release, it's an enjoyment.
I must say, I do agree with you. I'm a Brompton owner myself, and I use it daily. And I will agree that it doesn't make my children any better behaved.
Me too.
If we were to talk about the production process, what's critical to make sure that things work here for you?
So, we've been through a journey. When Andrew started, it was two people. When I joined, we had 24. We now have 220. So it's been a journey of growing the business. And when you're making small quantities of bikes, you tend to make them in batch production. And as the company grows, you change, and evolution tends to move towards a line and cellular production, which is where mm-hmm. we are now. Mm-hmm. But in all elements of what we've done, we've always been obsessed with quality. Mm-hmm. And quality, not just in the product, but in how you make the product, in how you teach your staff, in how you look after the cleanliness. If you focus on that, what happens is you reduce waste, mm-hmm. you reduce rework, you reduce not knowing where things are. And all of that means that you end up offering better value to the customer. And that's all it's about. Wherever we can, we want to offer better value, reduce inefficiency, and therefore give the customer better value.
Well, that's fascinating, because if you look at the factory, to me it looks relatively old-fashioned, but you're espousing all of those very much up-to-date ideas about just-in-time and total quality and all of those sort of things. So those are very important to the way, the ethos of your company.
Well, it's very old-fashioned to you now, but I tell you, if you'd come 10 years ago, you'd have been mm-hmm. thinking we were in the Victorian era. Mm-hmm. So you're right. We are not Toyota, nor are we Triumph, but we are really becoming quite efficient. There's still lots of room for improvement, but there are elements that are really spectacularly cool. Mm. Some of the work that we're doing with Raspberry Pis, LCD screens, ability to communicate, some of the ways in which we're using Bluetooth to pick up torque wrench measurements, linked in to the particular bike with a particular operator. There's some quite clever stuff going on. And the exciting thing is, there's so much more we can do. You know, we aren't so perfect that you're just, you know, polishing and polishing. We have still got real efficiency to come, but it takes time and it can't all be done overnight.
Well, I noticed that it's very much a people business.
Yes.
Everybody here is talking to each other all the time.
Yeah.
And you're having all these signs up here about quality and all of that basis. Yeah. Presumably, it is down to the individual.
It's down to the team. Mm-hmm. It's funny, manufacturing historically is all about, I'm the boss, I know what's going on, I march about and I tell you what to do and you do what you're told. But in Brompton, personally, all I've done is recognize what I don't know. And I found people who have the knowledge and skills that I don't have. Mm. Happens that I don't actually have many knowledge and skills, so I've surrounded myself with loads of people who know loads of stuff. Now, if you accept that you don't know something and you bring someone in who does know, then clearly you can't tell them what to do. because they know more than you. That's why you employ them. Your job is not to tell them what to do, but to clear all the rubbish out of the way and give them the means to do what they know they can do, which is why you employ them. And it's as relevant to me and the people who work for me as it is for our guys who are making the bikes or doing the brazing. They know more about that job than their supervisor. Their supervisor is there to allow them to fulfill their potential, allow them to embed the knowledge they have into improving the process. And if you don't do that, you're not, you've got six people adding value rather than 160 people adding value.
Well, I look around and obviously there is some very skilled work going on here. In terms of training, how does that work for you? Is it very much on the job or do you use external training providers as well?
So we are quite a weird product. We're not a generic company doing a very competitive job that thousands of people do across the UK. Our brazing, when I joined, we have five brazers. They were like the last dodos. And if they went, we became extinct. And there was no training provider, no one had the skill. We had to nurture it in-house. And a lot of what we do in the technical element of our line is very unique. But there are loads of other generic skills that our team learn. Leadership, lean, welding, health and safety. So there's a whole pile of work that supports the growth of our staff to allow them to invest that knowledge into a particular niche skill that they have at Brompton. So it's a combination of both. We do a lot of internal, but also we have support externally.
And in terms of the financial side, the professional school that I run is predominantly about financial training.
Yeah.
With the massive growth that you've had, what have been your key financial issues?
I think the funny thing about finance is it's not about making profit, not making profit, making gross margin, making net profit, EBITDA, EBIT. That isn't actually, I don't think, what a business is about. What you need to run a business is visibility. If you understand what's going on and you're in control, then you have a solid business. If you decide that you're going to do some significant investment, increase your overhead, invest more in capex, increase your depreciation, then your profits are going to go down. But if you decide that's what you want to do, and you know what you're doing, you can see what's happening, and it's all controlled, then you can relax. What's not, which is seriously bad news, and it happened to us about 7 years ago, is when you are not in control, and you think you know what's going on, you keep getting surprises. As long as you plan it, and what you say happens, whether that's to increase profits or increase investment, it's all about control. And you get control by measuring performance, measuring your key KPIs, defining what they are at a particular moment in time. And over time, when certain KPIs are fully under control, embedded in the culture, you know that's fine. You can refine those KPIs and refine them and learn more and understand more. And you get better granularity, better understanding, and better optimization of the business.
Well, that's fascinating and very interesting to hear. So what you're really telling me, I think, is that you're looking at this as management information and your EBITDA is something that happens at the end of all of this.
Yes, and if you have good control of how the business is run, then you can model the business and you can predict your EBIT. And circumstances may change. Orders may not come in as you thought. Interest rates might change, but if your model reflects your business and the assumptions that you've made to build your model are based upon real thought through assumptions, then you have something that you can always adjust. You can see what's coming, you can adjust it, you can see the impact. Oh, we're going to have to do a bit of this, a bit of that. But it's when, it's like flying a plane in cloud. If your instruments aren't right, you're just going to nosedive. And that nearly happened to us. But if your instruments are right, you can take on all manner of unpredictables, because business isn't predictable, and you've got to be able to adjust. But if you're not measuring what's going on accurately, you know, you're all over the shop, and you start guessing, and that's very dangerous.
To what extent do you rely upon professional, qualified financial staff?
We have our financial director, who's a qualified accountant. We have another member of the finance team, who's a qualified accountant, and he did his chartered accountancy qualifications while here. And we had a third assistant member in the team, and she's going through all of her qualifications now. You must have that robust rigor and sort of embedded culture within your finance team, no question about it. But actually, that's your insurance policy. Far more important than that, actually, for a business, is that your company understands the fundamentals of how the business works. Labor cost per bike, revenue per bike, mm-hmm. gross margin, net profit, and everybody understands it, because they can contribute. Waste, you know, if they don't understand that all of this is leading to profitability, and actually we're not interested in profits. We're interested in more people riding bikes around the world. But mm-hmm. if we don't have the profits, we won't be able to fulfill our dreams. So it's part of the necessary output from the company to allow us to fulfill our potential. But that's far more important than having two people in a little finance desk and they're the only ones worrying about it. They're there as an insurance. They're there as an auditor to check that the rest of the team's assumptions are right. But the team have to live and breathe this business, profitability, waste, efficiency, and the customer. And if they don't have that, you're lost.
Well, Will, I must thank you very much. I think you've been very candid about what you need, what you do, and how you're trying to be successful. And I'm indebted for you for giving us a little bit of your time.
Well, it's my pleasure. We have a long, long way to go, but we're getting there little bit by little bit.
Brilliant. Thank you very much indeed.
Cheers.